So once it got big, and it seemed to get big pretty quickly, how did you manage to keep the creativity? How did you manage to concentrate on songwriting in the face of all the distractions that were going on? Because it was kind of unprecedented. I mean, I guess
Well,
the Beatles...
I think we had a hard time on the third album. With Seven Ragged Tiger, we started it with spending 2 months in a chateau in the south of France while the film festival was on. And then we took it to Montserrat. We took a third journey to Australia, to Sydney, before we could actually get it finished.
Comfortable, could we?
We kept changed everything. And I think we learned about the distraction, and we learned the fact that actually it was difficult, and it would run away if you let it. And we learned how to hang on to it.
Mm. It was a very challenging record, Seven and the Ragged Tiger. When the first single came out, and I think we were still working on the album, the first single came out, Union of the Snake, and we were all sitting around a table in Sydney listening to everything. It was all about the chart rundown on Sunday, you know, where was the single going to chart? And the single came in at number 5, and everybody was seriously... Was it 5 or 3?
4.
Three, I think it was.
We were seriously depressed.
You can live with number 3, can't you?
No. I mean, it was like you had to.
It entered at number 1, the third song ever to do it.
Yeah.
Where's it going to go from there?
We were on this treadmill, and everything had to.
The tragedy.
Yeah, I mean, it's just
the champagne
business,
just didn't have quite the same kind of fizz that it had before.
A few bubbles had popped before it got to your mouth. But then, of course, there's View to a Kill.
Yeah.
And that was interesting because presumably it was a commission.
Yeah, I met Cubby Broccoli, and just in a moment of like the kind of chutzpah that you have when you're 22 and in a really famous band, I just went up to him and said, you know, I was introduced to him and said, when are you going to have another good theme song again? And why don't you let us write it? And he said, call me tomorrow. So I went home, called the guys and said, I've just met this guy. I think we've got a crack at it. And went down to where they were. I went to his office, actually, in Mayfair, and he got me on the phone with John Barry. And, I mean, he basically said to John, I want you to make this work with these guys. So then we had to write it.
Mm. In about a week.
And that was an interesting
challenge. Yeah, we started writing it we were doing some filming at Shepperton Studio.
That's right.
And Nick had brought a little keyboard with him, and he started with those chords at the top of the song. Da, 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 da. And I started singing, meeting you with a view to a kill over the top of that. And once we had that first line, we were off.
It was written very, very quickly.
Yeah.
they needed it. The film was a long way along. I mean, they do decide very late with the Bond soundtrack. I think that's part of their tradition.
You sweat a little bit, maybe.
I don't know, it was quite interesting seeing the bit of film that was going to go before the title sequence. And then the bit that was coming after it. And they said, right, your song's going to be going in there.
We got Bernard Edwards in, who we'd not worked with before. So there was a lot went into making that song right, you know. So by the time the curtains opened and the titles, the Maurice Binder titles started, it was a really stunning, stunning piece of music.
Bernard Edwards from Chic.
Yeah.
So that must have been a big deal. Early influence, a hero.
Yes,
musically,
very much, absolutely. I mean, we'd met Niall a couple of times, and Niall couldn't do it. I bet he rused that day,
that moment.
Every day. But for some reason, Niall couldn't do it. And we'd worked with him on Wild Boys, hadn't we?
Yeah. Yeah.
So he was the guy that we... And for some reason...
Having his haircut that day or something.
I don't know. Or maybe he was off the list that week, but, you know, we thought about Bernard.
So you had it was a kind of songwriting challenge, you know. You had to do it in a week. It was a huge production. It was a Bond movie. Yeah. You know, so iconic.
Well, we had to fuse the Duran Duran sound with the Bond ethic. And I think it was very challenging for John Barry.
I do remember an altercation over a chord at the end of the chorus.
I do too.
La la chord.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, John was very fixed in his ways and obviously had been hugely successful. And it was a challenge for him having to deal with us.
Needless to say, Nick won the argument.
I think
he's quite a prickly
customer. What was the argument?
It was just over a major chord
change. It was a note.
It was a note.
A note.
Yes. Yeah.
The kind of things
musicians
argue about,
imagine. Very important to know. But I mean, after all of that, I think we created something really strong.
So let's hear you perform it live. Let's say you want to write a new song. Does it happen that you arrive and none of you have any idea what you're going to do, and then maybe say, Roger, would you start doing a drum beat, and then everything will build up from there? Does that happen like that, though, that one person
will
start
playing? Funny, I think Roger does actually start them most of the time, because we usually say, what should we do? Should we write a fast one or should we write a slow one?
We need a really late anyway, so I get in it first.
Right.
No, but I think, actually, Wild Boys, I think, came from something that... which we're not playing here, but that's a track that came from something that Nick and I were doing. I think we're trying to do something like Peter Gabriel, where he used to have these great big kind of tom fills on the records, and there'd be very little cymbals, it would all be tom-toms, and I thought I was trying something like that, and then Nick started playing a sequencer or a set of chords, and that came from that. So the songs can really come from any direction, from a guitar lick or a drum beat or whatever, or a lyric like The Chauffeur.
We're quite good at knowing when any one of the band has found something special. And it doesn't matter really to us where it's come from. What matters is that we've got this treasure that we can then make the song out
of. That must be difficult, though. Sorry to interrupt, but I mean, you all seem like lovely guys, but I'm sure, like everyone in the world, you've all got egos. So, you know, everyone has. So how does that work?
I think when it comes to it, our ears are more important than our egos.
Okay, so you can...
When you hear something that special, you forget about whether you came up with it, whether somebody else did or something. In a way, I know that when Nick comes up with something, it belongs to me. When I come up with something, it belongs to everybody.
It's the collective ego is the really big one.
Yes, yeah.
I mean, there has been times... we've been doing this a long time. So there have been times when it has been floated. Maybe we just need to write individually. We just didn't go for it, for whatever reason. We just didn't go for it. And now, this process that we have, we hold on to it fiercely, because it really is the one thing that defines us, you know, for better or worse. And we've all ridden it through hard times and good times. You know, sometimes when it's dry, you go through a dry few weeks, months, and then suddenly you hit something. And there's something really exciting about just showing up without any preconceived. That'd spoil it. It'd spoil the fun of it. Mm-hmm. It's like, what do we do when we interact? What happens?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's what makes it exciting.
You're talking about chemistry, basically. That's that's the thing. I mean, there was something which I think you said about Prince being a genius, and you're saying, well, we don't feel that we're geniuses, but we feel that together there is something that no one else does, and there's something really special here.
Yeah.
I don't know about that bit about not being geniuses.
Maybe I did that bit. Do you believe in shame? This song, Simon, did this come out from a pretty tragic situation?
Yeah, it did. One of my best friends in the whole world died. He got into drugs, and when he thought he'd beaten it, he got dragged back into it and just took one bad evening and he was dead. It really, really got to me. I almost felt like it was my fault as well, because I was supposed to be seeing him around that sort of time. And a song really came out of that, and I dedicate it to him in my heart every time we play it, you know. And I dedicated a little part of me to him. And I say that in the song, you know, I believe there's a little part of you inside of me that'll never die. And I still believe that's true.
That's a really tough thing to write about.
Yeah.
Does it help to deal with it by writing about it, though?
For me, it does, yeah. It helps me. And it did at the time. It helped me a lot.
Do you believe in love? Do you believe in shame? And if love can conquer all, then why'd we only feel the pain? I heard you speak my name, heard you sing in the stone, maybe caught you laughing in the light of static.
world. It's a very, very reflective song. It's a different sound, and it's almost like classic songwriting. It sounds like that, you know. It sounds like the kind of song which the structure is brilliant, and the mood is more melancholic, more reflective. So beyond the situation of your friend's death, was it also reflecting the band situation of having years to reflect on, basically?
You know, when I wrote the lyric of it, it wasn't at all. It was very much I broke down actually on a flight, and I really said, I've got to get this out of my system, and it really was me freeing myself from the sadness and the loss.
It was a turning point, because I don't think we'd written a song like that up until that point. We'd not written a song. This is Shame I'm talking about. We'd not written a song that was as personal and as pertinent to that as that song before. It then gave us permission. It opened up a whole new, as you said, ordinary world we wouldn't have written.
Yeah.
Without Shame.
Yeah.
Ordinary World, when we'd finished that song, we really did know that we had something very special. There was something so uplifting about the chorus. It's a melancholic song, but at the same time, it brings a real surge of energy.
it's a song about survival.
Yeah.
In the face of adversity, in the face of loss, in the face of everything that can go wrong going wrong. And you know, people have projected a lot on that and said, well, there are parallels with what the story of the band was, and having had so much and then having that taken away. And as I said, it wasn't something that was in my mind when I wrote it, but now when I look back on it, I think, yeah, I must have been drawing on that experience as well.
Well, I think...
because it
you know, I was just going to say, most of the best lyrics to me are lyrics where people can interpret the meaning themselves.
When they work on different levels.
Yeah, and when they touch a nerve with people.
Mm. So do you still feel that, coming from that very, very personal place, do you feel that this is my song, or this is now the world's property and they can interpret it?
I've thought about this a lot. I really do believe that up until the point it gets released, it's my song, it's our song. But then as soon as somebody else hears it, it belongs to them.
Yeah. But that is
what I love about music, and that's what I love about what we do. We get, and with Ordinary World, we got people writing to us saying, you know, you've said something that's made it easier for me to cope with things that are going on in my life. And to me, that's the best thing we can do. If we can help people feel that they're not alone, there's somebody else who feels like them, there's somebody who understands what they're going through, then we're doing something useful.
Yeah. And then they're everyone's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the power of music.
Yeah.
Well, I think we should mention Warren at this point, because he's a very big part of that.
Yeah, very
song.
Much so.
You know, he actually came up with the verse melody for Ordinary World, and then he was a big part of it, and I think he is the closest thing we ever had in the band to a classically trained.
He's a virtuoso.
Yeah.
I'm going to pronounce his surname wrong, but Warren
Cucurullo.
Cucurullo. Mm. And he won an Ivor Novello Award, so you've got the stamp of approval.
We spent a long time in that writing period, though. We come off the back of the Liberty album, which had been our least successful album commercially, and we really wanted to rethink things. And we thought, well, the one thing we should do is we should go back to our songwriting and really keep writing until we've got enough strong songs that we're completely happy with. And that was the sessions that Ordinary World came out of, and then later Come Undone.
We were on parole.
Mm. We were.
You know, we'd had a whole, for the length of our career up until that, we'd basically had an open checkbook. And when we started on that record, that AMI had said, we're giving you this, and then we want to hear what you've written. You know, we had to, like, show up with the songs. And fortunately, Ordinary World was pretty early in the writing. When they heard that, they're like, okay, we know we've got one. Then they felt comfortable giving us more money to finish the project. But, you know, it doesn't hurt to have those kinds of restraints on you.
Not at all, and to have a bit of fear, I would have thought, as well.
Thank you.
Reach Up for the Sunrise. This is a anthemic. What's the story with this song?
It's another antidepressant, isn't it? You know, I was thinking how much, you know, how much goes into antidepressant drugs, you know, and everybody's obsessed with with depression, and how music, you know, you can be in the worst place in your head and you turn on the radio and the right song comes on and 3 minutes later you're a completely different person. You know, that's why I think we do this, because, you know, you're dealing with something that's entirely non-addictive, unharmful, and it can just change everything. And Sunrise was, that was the reunion.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it kind of came from Saint-Tropez.
Yeah,
because we got back together to do a songwriting session. And one night we all went down to this club in Saint-Tropez, which the name escapes me, but it was a great club.
The Carve Du Roy.
That's Roy's right. Place.
Yeah. Roy's Cave.
And it was kind of, all this kind of French disco music was happening. I mean, Daft Punk.
Starlight.
Yeah.
Starlight,
that
record we were listening to.
Starlight.
Yeah. So we tried to kind of, we tried to cop that groove a bit. Some of that kind of French four on the floor kind of dance music.
Andy Taylor, rock guitar.
Yeah.
Coming back into it, had he got even more rockier?
I thought not. He could, actually. When he first started, I thought he was sounding a bit like the Isley Brothers a lot, and he's sounding a lot like or the Doobie Brothers. He got into this kind of
funk.
Smoothie stuff, but we soon got him to go back to his rock and roll stuff.
Got back into ribs.
Yeah, I mean, Andy's a rocker through and through.
That's where it comes
from. I love
from.
Him for it too.
I mean, Sunrise, when we'd written that, it was one of a batch. There was another one called Taste the Summer that was a similar sort of groove. And we were putting the album together, and it was a standout track. It ended up being the first single. But the version that we're playing here is actually very different than the recorded version. It's a hybrid of the recorded version and one of the remixes, and it's developed from us playing live and seeing what worked with an audience.
So actually playing live becomes part of the songwriting process in a sense.
Well, very much. It was always part of our process early on. We'd write a song and we'd go and try it out at the show that night to see how it went. And we'd say, not sure the middle really worked.
Yeah.
We seemed to lose the interest there. And it was a really good gauge, actually.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, of course, now it's very difficult to do that because it ends up then your version that you didn't like ends up on YouTube that evening.
The music between us. The music between us. The music. The music between us. Now the time has come, the music between us. Though the night seems young, is at an end. Only change will bring you out of the darkness. In this moment, your hands into the big sky. You can touch the sunrise, hear the new day. It's
How about The Valley? When was this written?
The Valley was one of the songs that we wrote with Nate Hills, who also produced that track. It was on the Red Carpet Massacre album. Those sessions were done in Sphere Studios in London. We decided with the Red Carpet Massacre project to actually collaborate with other writers. We'd not really done very much of that, apart from the odd thing. And it was a real challenge for us to let somebody else into that door and say, OK, you become part of our unit and let's see what we get. It was a very different process, though, having someone else involved.
Boy, did we argue about this I was kicking and screaming about this song
right.
from way back.
With the production.
I was going, I don't like it. I can't come up with a melody for it.
You've got the melody.
I said, and Nate was going, it's my favourite thing on the record so far.
God. Yeah, well, when we all jammed together on the thing, Simon came up with a great melody for it. But for some reason, he just had a mental block about it and decided he didn't like it.
That verse melody at the time.
And you know, also, like, he would come up and the lyrics, that what he was singing, which he hadn't put a lot of thought into, to me, they spoke to me straight away. I knew exactly what it was about. He didn't have a clue what it was about. But to me and the rest of us, we were like, The Valley. It's about the guy. It's about reality. It's how it is out there. It's that jungle out there called London or New York or Los Angeles or whatever, and it's the individual against, and all of this in a few words that he's just scattered off.
I mean, I'd sung this blah blah melody thing, and Nate went, that's it. I went, no, it's not. And he went, yes, it is. And I, oh God, we argued for days about it. And actually, before I liked it, I just had to trust him. I actually trusted him. Because he was outside of the band. Because, you know, ego does come into it. And well, if it had been one of these guys, if they'd have been sort of like championing it, it would have been much more difficult for me to capitulate. Mm-hmm. But because Nate was the guy, I was able to accept it. I was able to go, okay, you're the producer. Okay, I'm just going to go with what you think. I don't like it. I'm just going to sing it, and I sang it, and sort of don't like it. And then 2 weeks later, I was thinking, bad, you know, it's not bad, it's all right, and it grew on me.
It's got to sit around for a bit, yeah. I guess, until
yeah, and then I played to the family, and my wife says, oh, that's my favorite song on the album.
Like Simon says, you know, he couldn't trust us. Was there another agenda? And I think for us musicians, again, we were going through a period where we were redefining the band. Andy had left the group, mm-hmm. so we had to redefine the sound of the band. And we were listening to this, and we were saying, "This is it. We've got it. This is a new. This is the new sound." Where Simon, I think, was still in the pure, like, well, the song. He was in the song mode.
Okay.
But we were like Nick. We were thinking widescreen.
Yeah. Thinking of the producer, the production.
Architecturally.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. Yeah. I wanted it to have a beginning, a middle, and an end. And you would say, no, it just has to have a riff. It just has to have the bits that make sense at that time.
Roger, how does it work when a producer comes along, Nate comes along and says, OK, I want this kind of drum sequence mm-hmm. to play along with your drums? What's that process like? I mean, do you have to fight to keep your sound or blend it in?
We had to kind of stand back a little bit because we used to being so... Well, the previous album was so much in control of everything. You know, it was very much an album that we really did co-produce, and this is the first time since probably the Sheet Corporation in the 80s that we really let somebody in.
There's a nice anecdote for me. You know, the song on the album ends with a fade, and when we went to play it live, we were talking about, well, how are we going to end it? And Roger said, well, I just been to see the Joy Division premiere. He'd been talking to the drummer. He said, and they just slowed down. It just went to the drums, and they just slowed it down and stopped. And we were like, okay, let's try that. We went all the way back to 1981 to get a drum outro, which we put on the end of it, which I thought was kind of
nice. And then it works.
Yeah.
With everyone, there's a moment of our life.
You're free.